Good morning, church. Welcome, welcome. We're so grateful that you have set aside this time. Whether you're here in the room or worshiping with us online, we're grateful that you have set aside this time to prioritize being together as the body of Christ and to prioritize worshiping, praising our God. Amen?
Amen.
What a blessing it is to have the chance to do that. I want to call attention before we begin this morning to those flowers right there on the piano. Josh, tell us what those are for.
Those are for Emily and I's 7th wedding anniversary.
Hey! We praise God for that, for your marriage, for those 7 years, and we ask that God gives you many more blessed and purposeful years together. So God bless you. Friends, I'm aware this morning, as I'm sure you are, that this is September 11th, and it's a day that continues to remind us of the brokenness of our world, the power of reckless hate. But it also reminds us of all of those who stepped out and made sacrifices that day for the good of others. So even as we grieve, we also celebrate the fact that we are children of a God who is still working. We celebrate the fact that God gives us purpose, that God calls us to do the best that we can be, to use the gifts that God gives us to continue to work for wholeness in this fragmented world. Amen. I would encourage you to take a deep breath, to know that the Spirit of God is in this place. Would you stand as you are able in body or spirit, as we welcome the light of Christ, and as we worship together.
So much we have lost as we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked. One by one, the enemy has whispered lies and led them off as slaves. But we know that you are God, yours is the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we step into the valley unafraid. We call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive. Come alive, up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive. God of endless mercy, God of unrelenting love, rescue every daughter, bring us back the wayward sons. By your Spirit, breathe upon them. Show the world that you alone can save. You alone can save. We call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive. Breathe the breath of God now. Breathe the breath of God. Breathe the breath of God now. Breathe. Breathe the breath of God now. Breathe the breath of God. Breathe the breath of God now. Breathe. We call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive.
Be seated, church.
Before we pray, I wanted to just bring attention to these beautiful quilts and prayer shawls that have been made lovingly. We're going to bless them in our prayer today. But also, if you know of anybody who needs one of these, maybe they are facing surgery or about to have a new baby or they've lost a loved one, any reason for prayer is a reason to bless someone with a prayer shawl. So let us know. Reach out at the office, or if you quilt or knit or crochet and would like to contribute to bless someone, we would love to include you in this ministry. Will you join me in prayer? God of wonder, God of grace and love, we come today offering our lives once again in thanks and praise for all the ways you bless us and give us life. We come before you brokenhearted as we confront the giants of our own making, violence, addiction, fear and trauma, sickness and disease that remind us of our own mortality, relationships lost, contorted by our insecurities and pride. Forgive us, God, and restore us to wholeness. We're also broken open. Pain that spills out on this anniversary marking the 21 years since our country was rocked by terrorism as we watched planes crash and towers fall. So too did our sense of safety and of freedom. Teach us, God, to live differently than the ways that we see on TV and on our phones. Teach us a way of vulnerability and grace, of courageous love and truth-telling. Send your Holy Spirit to comfort and inspire us this morning, to tend to those places that we cannot see with our own eyes. Mend our hearts with your abundant love. Clothe us in your grace as we turn from despair to hope. God, we lift up Acton United Methodist Church, Carol McCann, Jason Newsom, Sue and Nick Nicholas, John Williams Sr., and we pray your blessing on them for healing and hope and restored health. We also ask your blessing on the beautiful prayer shawls made and presented today for Kathy Murray and her daughter Robin, Rex McSparren, father of Marcia Shields, Sunday Lindsay, daughter of Pat and Lou Hendricks, and two of our dear friends in Christ who remain anonymous. Pour your spirit over them that they would be comforted and reassured of your love and your healing presence in their lives. Thank you for the people who made these quilts. God, remind us all of your creative hand at work in our lives, the one that knit us together in our mother's womb, the one that weaves us together as co-creators with you, to build your world where everyone is fed and housed and safe. Help us to hold hands with those in need. We ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
That song. Be seated, church. I love that song. And even more than that, I love the passion with which this praise team leads it. Thank you all. And thank you, church, for praising your God in that beautiful way. All right, we're entering into a new sermon series this week. We're going to do 4 weeks. This was actually Pastor Austin's idea. So if you don't like the series, you take it up with Austin. Okay. And the name of the series is Revisited, Stories from Our Youth. So we're going to take four the biblical stories these are some of the ones that you read, you know, and learned about when you were 6, 7 years old in Sunday school. You probably still have assumptions based on how you learned those stories when you were 6 years old about what those mean. And our purpose in the series is to revisit these. All right, we're going to go back, maybe unpack them a little bit more deeply than we did in first grade Sunday school, kind of wrestle with these stories together and reclaim them in the truth within them. So next week, Pastor Amy is going to walk us through the story of Noah's Ark. All right, I'm going to do Wee Zacchaeus in week 3. Pastor Austin on October 2nd is going to do Jonah and the whale. Today, we're going to talk about David and Goliath. All right, and I actually love, kudos to Carly Bold. She created this little graphic on the front of your bulletin. You'll see that coming out of the Bible there, all four of those stories are represented graphically. We've got the ark there, we've got the whale, we've got little Zacchaeus up in the tree. You'll notice that Goliath here is apparently a very muscular cyclops gorilla. Probably not exactly what he was. Okay, that may be kind of the image that we have in our minds of Goliath, but let's unpack this a little bit today. So first, I want to put the story in context, all right? Where is the story in the Bible? What was the historical context? Where does this fit in to the story of the Hebrew people? Comes from the book of 1 Samuel, okay, which is the 9th book of the Bible. Reviewing quickly here, the first 5 books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, the Pentateuch, okay, talks about our origin story as human beings, the origin story of the Hebrew people, God's covenant with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, captivity in Egypt, the rise of Moses, who leads the people out of Egypt into the Sinai, 40 years wandering in the wilderness, during which God gave the law to Moses, who ultimately led the people right to the threshold of the promised land before he died. The book of Joshua, then, the 6th book, talks about the story of the people entering into and battling for and ultimately taking possession of the promised land. They set up a government led by a series of judges. Story told in the book of Judges, right? Good, you're getting this, right? It all connects. Okay, the 8th book of the Bible, Ruth, tells a beautiful narrative of the faith and love of two women, Ruth and Naomi, and that brings us to the 9th book of the Bible in 1 Samuel. By the way, that was 1,000 years and 400 pages of text that I just gave you in 30 seconds there. So there's that. There's that. All right. That brings us to the 9th book of the Bible, and a prophet and priest, eventual prophet and priest named Samuel, is born, called by God, and he leads the people faithfully for many years. He tries to put his sons in power as he ages. That doesn't go well. The sons are corrupted, as so often happens with human beings, and the people come to Samuel, and they say, "We want a king. Give us a king for our people." And Samuel takes that to God, and God listens, and God says right there, 1 Samuel 8:22, "Listen to them and give them a king." So Samuel anoints the first king, King Saul, around 1020 BC. Saul rules for about 42 years until he too is unfaithful to God. And God rejects him as king and sends Samuel to anoint another king. It says, "Go to a man named Jesse in Bethlehem, and there you will find the one I'm calling to be the next king." And so you know the story, right? Samuel goes and goes to the home of Jesse and says, "Bring out your sons." And Jesse begins a parade of his 7 older sons, and one by one they come by, and Samuel says, "Nope, nope, 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 nope. Don't you have any more sons?" And Jesse said, "Well, there's the boy." And out comes David. Okay. Meanwhile, The Hebrew people have been continuing to battle to hold the promised land. There are lots of regional peoples in the area. They continue to battle, particularly with the Philistines, the people of a region called Philistia, kind of to the southwest, what we call today the Gaza Strip. It's a pentapolis of five major cities, including Gaza itself and the city of Gath, which is going to play a prominent role in today's story. So the people of Israel battle and continue to battle with these people between the period of the judges and the later rule of King Hezekiah. There are in Scripture seven battles described between the Hebrew people and the Philistines, the fifth of which happens soon after what we just talked about, the call by Samuel of the young future King David. And so we find ourselves at 1 Samuel 17. Now, I'm going to go ahead. We're going to read most of this story. We're not going to put the words up because it's a little long for this. We want you to just focus on hearing the words, maybe seeing a little bit visually the words of this story. All right, 1 Samuel chapter 17. Now, the Philistines gathered their armies for battle. Down in verse 3, the Philistines stood on the mountain on the one side. Israel stood on the mountain on the other side with a valley between them. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. Now, let me just give a little bit of context on that real quick. This is maybe pretty accurate here. We think of, I hate typecasting, but yeah, I don't, you know, it just had to be you, Tim. Now you lean into it. All right, so 6 cubits and a span. We think of, you know, Goliath being a giant, maybe like in the Lord of the Rings sense or something, 25 feet tall. 6 cubits and a span, scholars say, translates to about 7'10" in modern terms. I looked it up. The tallest man in the world alive today is a Turkish farmer who's 8'3". So it's possible, 7'10", okay? Scholars also say, however, I thought this was interesting, I didn't know this, that the wall of the city of Gath was 6 cubits and a span thick, okay? So it could be that Samuel was saying, you know, this champion, this huge guy, he was a really big guy, as thick as the wall of the city that he came from, all right? Or maybe he was 7'10". All right, he had a helmet of bronze on his head. He was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. His shield bearer went before him. He stood up and shouted to the ranks of Israel,
"Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? Are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us."
And the Philistine said,
"Today I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man that we may fight together."
When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Verse 16, "For 40 days the Philistine came forward and took his stand, morning and evening. Jesse said to his son David," the brothers were in the battle, okay, against the Philistines down there. "And Jesse said to his son David, 'Take for your brothers an ephah of this parched grain and these 10 loaves and carry them quickly to the camp to your brothers. Also, take these 10 cheeses to the commander of their 1,000. See how your brothers fare and bring some token from them.' Now Saul and they and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. David rose early in the morning, left the sheep with a keeper, took the provisions, and went as Jesse had commanded him. He came to the encampment." Come to the encampment, David. "As the army was going forth to the battle line, shouting the war cry, Israel and the Philistines drew up for battle, army against army. David left the things in charge of the keeper of the baggage, ran to the ranks, and went and greeted his brothers. As he talked with them, the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, came up out of the ranks of the Philistines and spoke the same words as before, and David heard him. All the Israelites, when they saw the man, fled from him and were very much afraid. The Israelites said, "Have you seen this man who has come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel. The king will greatly enrich the man who kills him and will give him his daughter and make his family free in Israel." David said to the men who stood by him, I didn't green that line. You should have had that line too. Verse 26.
What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is the uncriticismed Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?
Yes, who is this uncircumcised Philistine? The people answered him in the same way. So shall it be done for the man who kills him. His eldest brother Eliab heard him talking to the men, and Eliab's anger was kindled against David. He said, "Why have you come down? With whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your presumption and the evil of your heart, for you have come down just to see the battle." And in the words of every child ever, David said,
"What have I done now? It was only a question."
He turned away from him toward another and spoke in the same way, and the people answered him again as before. When the words that David spoke were heard, they repeated them before Saul, and he sent for him. David said to Saul,
"Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine."
Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you're just a boy, and he's been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul,
Your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came, you took a lamb from the flock. I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth. And if it turns against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this
It's a tough word, yeah. Go ahead. This Philistine
shall be like one of them, since he has defied the armies of the living God.
David said,
"The Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will save me from the hands of the Philistine."
So Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul,
"I cannot walk in these, for I am not used to them."
So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in his shepherd's bag in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David,
"Am I a dog that you would come to me with sticks?"
And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David,
"Come to me and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field."
I've been looking forward to hearing you say that all week. But David said to the Philistine,
"You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom have you defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I shall strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies to the Philistine army, this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all the assembly may know that the Lord, does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into your hand.
When the Philistine drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. Face down on the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, striking down the Philistine and killing him. There was no sword in David's hand. Then David ran and stood over the Philistine. He grasped his sword, drew it out of its sheath, and killed him. Then he cut off his head with it. When the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. This is the word of God for the people of God, and together we say, thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Friends, the first time, one more time, thank you, Tim, thank you, Kaylee, we appreciate you. It's beautifully done. The first time that I remember hearing the story, it probably wasn't the first time I actually heard it, okay? I was a church kid, PK, and having said that, the first time that I remember hearing it, I was 8 years old watching the movie Hoosiers, all right? Quoted in the movie Hoosiers, 1986, the boys of lowly little Hickory High, enrollment 64, going to play in the championship game against the Mighty Bears of South Bend Central, enrollment 2800. I've seen it 100 times. I could quote the whole thing to you. And there they are in the locker room before the game. And Coach Hackman, you know, gives the amazing inspirational pregame speech. And then they call the preacher up, and he comes up, and he takes out his Bible, and he says, and David put his hand in the bag and took out a stone and slung it and struck the Philistine on the head, and he fell to the ground. Amen. And frankly, I think that's sort of how this story and this imagery tends to get used in our society, right? As inspiration for underdogs in the sports world. Had a camp counselor, I think I was in middle school, who said to me, he probably was, you know, only 21 or 22 himself, okay? He said to me, the meaning of this story is that it's not the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. Which is most decidedly not the meaning of the story, okay? Just so we're all clear. Even cereal companies have used the imagery from this story to sell cereal, with the idea that, you know, really, really good cereal can make some kind of conquering hero out of a young boy, okay? Well, you know better. You know better than that. That's not the message of the story. I would claim to you today that the real message of the story isn't even fundamentally about winning, okay? We live in a society that is obsessed with winning. And at our best, we think the story means that because God's strength is greater than human strength, which is true, but because that's true, that even the longest underdog who has faith in God can win. Maybe so, but I don't think quite gets there as far as what the core message of the text is. What I think the story is really about is actually kind of what we talked about last week. We didn't plan it this way, but the Spirit moves in mysterious ways, right? As a matter of fact, the first article that I read this week as I was studying this text anew quoted what we talked about, last week's passage from Ephesians chapter 6, right? Resting in the strength of God, putting on the armor of God, that it's not about outcomes, but about a faithful journey, stepping out onto the field in faith. The call isn't, have faith and you'll defeat those people you don't like. The message isn't, have faith and you'll get what you want. The message is, go all in on what God wants. Go all in on what God wants. Center yourself in what God desires. However crazy you think it might be, what God desires. Center yourself in that. Center yourself in what God desires and take what you've got and step out onto the field of life, trusting that what God wants will be. Really isn't about winning, friends. It's about losing ourselves in the love, in the justice, in the strength of God. Amen? You believe God is calling you to a ministry that doesn't make sense? Step out onto the field and serve. I think of our friends Ron and Anita Brandstetter. Some of you remember them. They were members here for a long time. And Ron was wrapping up a successful career in business. He was 60, 61 years old, and discerned a call to go to seminary and start a career in ministry. I wonder what Anita's first response was, but they prayed about it together. No, and I mean, I think some of us were probably thinking, Ron, you're about to retire. You know, you're supposed to just relax and travel. Maybe God has a purpose for you yet. And that's true for all of you, by the way, whether you feel called to go to seminary or not. Okay, you're called to ministry in one form or another. But Ron was called to go to seminary, and he did, and eventually was called to serve a church. And it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether he ended up ministering for 3 years or 40. The message is in the call. Step out in faith. Take what you got and go serve and trust the results to God. You think God is calling you to take a risk in a relationship? Maybe a broken friendship? Ooh, this feels risky. I'm probably not going to be well received. Well, if God is calling you to it, you step out in faith and love. Maybe you have terminal cancer, but you believe that God has a purpose for you yet. What's the message of this text? The message is that you draw on the strength of God, that you live with everything you've got, and you trust the outcomes to your God. Scholar Bruce Birch, I love this, talking about the meaning of this text. Scholar named Bruce Birch put it this way. He said, this story is for those faced with the giants of oppression, who know that their own courage, their own resourcefulness will not be enough, and that their only hope lies with a living God. David's trust is not in the technology of force, but in the subversive power of truth. And the truth in this story is that God ultimately stands against arrogant, self-serving power and its violence. Trust in God nurtures hope that there is a way into the future where there seems no way, that a well-placed stone of opposition to evil can bring down seemingly impregnable systems of oppression and illness and brokenness that loom as armored giants. Friends, the best David and Goliath story that I've heard in a long time was told to me this week by a woman in this church. It reminded me of a story that you told probably about a year ago, okay? A woman in the church told me the story of the birth of her son. He was born and had severe, severe health issues, okay? To the point where the doctors said, he's not gonna make it, okay? We're talking about minutes or hours. And what they wanted to do was put him in a little crib in the corner so that he could breathe his last. And she said, you give me that baby. Because whether he lives for seconds or years, he will be held. Because I am his mother and he is my son. And he will be held. And she said that knowing that she and he both would be held. That baby had a birthday recently. He's 32.
this table has meant a lot of things to me throughout the years. I grew up in a different tradition, and I spent some time in different traditions, and so the table has been different throughout the years. And as I was thinking about this theme of revisited, you know, it's not just the stories that we hear as children, but it is the things that we do. Is the table that represents something as a child and might represent something else as an adult. And as I was thinking about it, you know, this table is revisited every week. And I think it means something different every week. Because when we come to the table, we're not coming with the same exact people every time. We might not be in the same place in line every time. And so we get a different perspective. And that's what stories are about, perspective, right? As a kid, we get a certain perspective of a story that helps us see it in a certain way. When we come to the table, we get a certain perspective, a perspective of community that comes with us, the perspective of a week that maybe has been hard that we're taking with us to the table. You know, we all come to it differently and experience it here differently. And I am so grateful that we revisit this table every week. Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, sat down with his disciples and his friends, and he offered them a different perspective of a meal. He said, you know, you're going to sit together lots of times in your life. You're going to have meals lots of times in your life. But this time, I want you to remember me. On the night that he was betrayed, he took a common loaf of bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, see, this is my body. And it's broken for you. This is the perspective that you get to see through. Remember me. Look through my eyes at the world around you. Put me back together. In the same way, he took the cup and looked at them and said, this cup is a new covenant. You've had one perspective up until now. This is a new thing that we're doing here. Every time that you drink of this cup, remember me. For every time that you eat this bread and every time that you drink this cup, you come to the table anew. You revisit the table from your childhood. You revisit the table from last week. You remember me. Hear the prayer of our elders.
Lord, how do we begin to thank you for your sacrifice? Do not let us take communion for granted today, but let us realize the greatness of your gift and the greatness of your love for us. We make mistakes, we stumble, we try to be in control of our lives, and yet, deep down, we know it is you who is the driver. You are steering the ship. You know our every thought. Please let us listen and be guided by you. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.
All are welcome at the table to step out in faith and to know that you are held here. Amen.
Storm surrounding me, let it break. At your name, still, call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave. At your name, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, breathe, call these bones to live. can call these lungs to sing once again. I will praise Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. Your name is a light, and the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is a light that the shadows can deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is life, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus.
Amen. I've never heard that song. That was beautiful. I like that. Okay, church, I'm going to start with an invitation and then bring in some announcements and then bring it back to the invitation. So we talk about our invitation here to five things at First Christian: prayer, service, presence, generosity, and study. And then as I looked at the announcements, there are elements of these five invitations in each of these. Study maybe not so much this week, because instead of our normal Sunday school offerings for adults, we are going to be meeting in the gym for an all-church conversation. This is something that we instituted in our bylaws a few years back, and then we sort of lapsed in COVID, as many things did, and we haven't had one for a while. So it's an opportunity for everyone, even if you're new to us, to come and maybe learn a little bit more about how our church functions and makes decisions, communicates, chooses leaders. And then to ask questions if you have them, clarify, and just to get to know each other and have some conversation. We'll have elders at each table, and so they're there to help facilitate and answer questions. Or if you want to reach out to one of us as staff, we'd be happy to follow up with you. So no Sunday school today. That's the first announcement. Secondly, these prayer shawls, except, yes, children. Children have Worship and Wonder and JYF. The prayer shawls are an opportunity to serve. They're also an opportunity to pray. And if you all want to come up right after the service and offer your own blessing on them, you're welcome to do so before heading to the gym for our conversation. Also, Wednesday at 4 o'clock, we have our weekend food for kids sacking program, where we prepare lunches for children to take home over the weekend. That's an opportunity for service, so you can come Wednesday at 4 to help with that. Next Saturday at 5 o'clock, we have cobbler and ice cream. Who doesn't love that? And then at 6, we're going to have a hymn sing and organ concert with Zavoni Nagy. Nagy, I'm saying his last name right, don't I? It's hard. We'll all learn together. Zavoni is his first name. And he is going to be starting here officially in October. But this is sort of his introduction to the congregation, a really beautiful time to celebrate his music and to welcome him and get to know him. So that's Saturday at 5. Grief Group is starting up again Monday, September 19th at 6:30 in the gathering area for anyone who is grieving, led by our own Amy and Danny Dwight. Also, on the tile table out in the narthex is a sign-up sheet. Next week, we're having a shot clinic for COVID boosters and flu vaccines. If you want one of those, just sign up, and we'll make sure to have enough shots for everyone. That's just outside to the left here, and that will be next Sunday all morning. Is that right, Cheryl? Okay, thank you. Okay, that was a lot of announcements. Now, back to the invitation. Heath, could you put up a picture for me? I wanted to share this with y'all. So this is three of our own children here at church. This was taken on Thursday at the middle school gym. Pastor Austin told me that he was going to be coming to my daughter Zoe's volleyball game. He's her youth minister, and I said, oh, that's beautiful, thanks so much. What I wasn't counting on was his entire family and the entire Bold family showing up with a handmade sign for Zoe. And it brought tears to my eyes, y'all. This was just so beautiful. And they held it upside down and screamed her name the whole time. And everybody was like, Zoe, you are really popular. You have the most fans of anyone in the gym. But these kids embodied church. Presence, when we talk about presence, showing up in this beautiful way for somebody and just saying, I love you, I celebrate you, I support you. It matters. It matters a lot. And they reminded me of that. So thank you, Pastor Austin. Thanks you all for showing up. That is how we show people we are Christians rather than telling people we are Christians. My grandma used to say, when somebody tells you who they are, listen. When somebody shows you who they are, believe them. This is the call to follow Christ. When he asks Peter, who do you say that I am? He says, you are the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, the Son of the living God. He knew that Jesus was showing himself before him and that his way was one of life and love. So if you would love to join us as we show people church, we would love to have you. As we stand and sing, the invitation is to give ourselves to Christ anew, each one of us today. But if you would like to join us in a formal way, we would love to have you. Will you join us and sing?
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy.
Promises her son, even when doctors say he will never live. Beheld by love, beheld by the promise that you belong to God, that there is a grace that holds the world together. And one day, we will all find our way home to love. Go in peace.
We call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive. God of endless mercy, God of unrelenting love, rescue every daughter, bring us back the wayward sons, and by your spirit breathe upon them, show the world that you alone can save, you alone can save. We call out the dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out the dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive.